good morning, everybody. I will present this work that is done at the Polytechnic of Torino. I will thank my co-author, that are Diego Valsesia, Giulio Colucci, and Enrico Magli. So, what is this talk about? Usually we have a huge amount of pictures that are shared every day on the, over the internet, and so we need some tools for categorizing, for classifying, for searching in this huge amount of pictures. The classical problem is looking for some picture of interest, and the classical approach is just to look for pictures that have some similar content. So we are content-based image retrieval. But in this talk, we will talk of a different approach. We will talk of a problem that is a forensic approach. We would like to look for pictures that are not acquired with some material content, but that are acquired by a specific device. So we would like to have, for example, a camera, and look over the internet for all the pictures that has been acquired by that specific camera. Why we would do something like that? A possible application, for example, is copyright protection. We can think of professional photographers that are uploading their picture over the internet. They have their own professional cameras. They want to look about if someone is just reposting or publishing their own picture without consent. This is a possible application. Another application is just for police investigation. Police come across some device that has been linked to some crime, for example, child pornography, for example, and they want to look over the internet for all picture that has been acquired by that specific device. But how can we do something like that? We can do something like that because in every picture we have a specific fingerprint that is called the photo response non-uniformity, that is specific to this particular sensor. So we can link a picture to a specific sensor. And that, what is important, what we've been presenting in this talk, is that we can have a very compact here new representation that is based on random projection. And this compact representation enables a search over these fingerprints on a very large scale. What is the scenario that we have in mind? We have a scenario like this, like a search engine for cameras. We assume that we have a Clorel program that is just searching the internet for picture, categorize the picture, and for each picture, this Clorel extracts the fingerprint and store the fingerprint in a dataset together with some link to that specific picture, for example, an URL address. Then we will think that we have a core module that receives as an input query a specific fingerprint of a given camera, and then look into the dataset for every picture that has been taken by that specific camera by comparing the fingerprint query with the fingerprint in the dataset. Just realizing a search engine like this poses a number of problems, practical problems, because first of all, the fingerprint dataset can be very large. For example, we can have millions, tens of millions, hundreds of millions, billions of pictures in that dataset in a realistic setting. Moreover, these peer new fingerprints have the same size as the sensor, the same size of a full frame of the picture. So it is very difficult to manage this huge dataset. And in this talk, we will show that our contribution is that we can propose efficient solution for implementing this search engine for cameras by using our proposed compression fingerprints. So, first of all, I will give you some basics on PRNU, what is this photo response non-uniformity. We use this for searching for cameras, for linking a picture to a given camera. Then we'll introduce our proposed compressive PRNU strategy that is based on random projections. And finally, I will discuss and just show some results about our image retrieval strategy that is based on this compressive PRNU implementation. What is this PRNU? PRNU is a photo response non-uniformity. It's just the fact that in the manufacturing of sensor, we have small imperfection in the manufacture of each pixel in the sensor. So each pixel has a slight different sensitivity to light, and this slightly different sensitivity makes a random fingerprint, a random multiplicative fingerprint that affect every pixel in the sensor, in the picture taken by that sensor. And we can just detect this particular noise-like pattern on each pixel of the picture just to extract this fingerprint and compare this fingerprint with a reference fingerprint. The characteristic of this fingerprint is that this fingerprint is multiplicative, that is, we have just this fingerprint pattern K we can just think that this picture is just an ideal picture, the scene, plus this fingerprint modulated by the pixel, by the content of the image, because this fingerprint is multiplicative. This is proportional to the intensity of the light on each pixel sensor. Of course, it has the same pixel size of the sensor. This is unique to each sensor. You cannot have two different sensors that have the same fingerprint. So this is a very unique feature for the identifying sensor. Moreover, is you can find this in every photo that is acquired by a specific device. This is stable to environmental characteristics, like, the, for example, temperature is stable over time, so it's very robust. And most important, this is robust to signal processing. That is, this is usually robust to, for example, JPEG compression, and even to resize. So you can use it in a realistic environment to link a picture to a specific device. Usually, how do you exploit PRNU in a particular application? You have to estimate the fingerprint. The finger you can estimate just by computing a noise residual. You assume to have a picture. You can just denoise the picture, and so you obtain a picture without any kind of noise, ideally. Then you subtract the noise picture, and you obtain the noise residual here. This noise residual, according to our model, is just the picture modulated by the fingerprint. So if you just divide the noise residual by the picture, you obtain an estimate of the PRNU fingerprint. Of course, you can extend this if you have multiple pictures. Here you have the maximum likelihood estimation that is just a weighted average of different noise residuals. What are the tasks usually implemented with PRNU? Usually forensic task has device identification. You have a photo, you want to see which kind of device, which device, according to the database of device, have taken the particular photo. You want to take if two different photos have been taken by the same camera. You could test if a specific fingerprint belong to a specific data set of fingerprint. A completely new problem that has been not addressed until now in the literature is the image retrieval problem. You have a fingerprint, you have a data set of picture, you want to test which one of these pictures has been taken by that camera with that specific fingerprint. And we will see how we can address this problem. The main ingredient in our problem is PRNU compression. Why we would like to compress PRNU? Because usually PRNU are the same size of the optical sensor. Usually sensor have a resolution of 10 million pixels at least. So you will have just a fingerprint that is 10 million entries, floating point values. Most importantly, you cannot opt to compress PRNU using traditional compression techniques like image coding, because this PRNU is noise-like, is highly incoherent. You cannot do compress with JPEG or other technique. So how can you deal with a very large data set of PRNU entry? You have a very large data set with your N is very large, 1 million picture, 1 million fingerprints. Every entry in the data set has 10 million entries. This is very difficult to handle. We can handle this by compressing the fingerprint to a more compact representation. And a very easy way, but a very efficient way, effective way to do this is using random projection. You just build a random matrix. This random matrix has a number of rows that is much less than the number of columns. And this is just built with the IID values, for example, Gaussian random values. And then you multiply this matrix by each fingerprint that you have to compress. The result is that you have just a compressed fingerprint with only M entries, when M usually is much, much less than N, so you have huge compression. And this works because, thanks to the Johnson-Lindenstrand lemma, this random projection matrix preserves correlation between the original fingerprints and the compressed fingerprints. If it preserves correlation, it also preserves distances. So if you search in the original space, if you search in this space, you are likely to obtain the same results. And so this is really interesting. We have some details, theoretical details, about how much is the degradation of performance according to M in this paper, recently published on the transaction information forensic and security. So we have so the in principle random projection works, it has good performance. The problem is random projection with a full random matrix is really expensive. Because we have, first of all, to generate n dot m random coefficients for each query. And this can be expensive. You cannot store the metric. The matrix is huge. You have to generate. And then you have a complexity of the product that is just quadratic, n times m. In order to solve this, you can resort to a different structure, different construction of the sensing matrix. You just generate a random the first row of the sensing matrix. This is just a row of n IID, for example, Gaussian random values. And then you generate every successive row of the matrix by just a circular shift of the first row. So just only n elements are generated at random. The last, the subsequent rows are obtained by a circular shift, for example, to the right, and then you have the complete matrix here. This is effective because, first of all, you have only to generate n random values at each query time, so it's much more efficient. And moreover, you can just perform matrix product by means of the EFFT. This particular circular a product by a circular matrix is just a circular convolution. The circular convolution can be implemented in the frequency domain by means of FFT and the inverse FFT. So the complexity from quadratics is just n log n. And so this is very efficient. And this works in practice because there are many results about in compressed sensing about the property, the embedding preserving properties or random circular matrix. And usually the Johnson-Lindau cross lemma holds also for this kind of matrices. So if you have, if we preserve distances with fully random matrix, usually we preserve distances also with these random circular matrices. A further complexity deduction that we can do with this construction is once we have the product with the vector, our random sensing matrix, instead of storing the floating point values of each random projection here, we can just store only the sign of the random projection. That is, we store either 1 or minus 1 according to the sign of the random projection. And this can be shown that is a banalization of entries in the fingerprint to preserve the angles, so preserve correlation and preserve distances. So if the distance is close, also the unbidden distances of this will be close. And then we have a much significant reduction about both storage, because we have only to store the single bits for each fingerprint entries. And also matching complexity is much more efficient, because a single matching is just an exclusive hour between our reference fingerprint and the query fingerprint. The performance of this compression strategy, we have just done some preliminary tests, and you can see that with respect to the uncompressed fingerprint, this is just the upper bound on the performance of the system, you have a very slight degradation. You have also the same performance by just using binarized fingerprint and using only about 500,000 bits for representing the fingerprint. So this is about 10 million floating point values, and this is just 500,000 bits. Moreover, this also performs quite well with respect to other fingerprint hash techniques that have been proposed in the literature. For example, just banalizing the projection or just using a fingerprint digest for performing this critique. We think that random projection has a performance that is best among all these state-of-the-art techniques for just reducing the size of appearing fingerprints. How can we use this for image retrieval? The setup of this mind is just the following setting. The system is given a database of n pictures, and we don't know the origin of this picture. We extract a single peer new fingerprint for each of these pictures, so we will have n different peer new fingerprints. We store a data set with the binary random projection of these fingerprints, and then we just present to the system a query in the form of a high-quality fingerprint just binarized with the same kind of random projection. We look for, in these preliminary results, we just look for the fingerprint of FM just by linear search. We compute the unbidden distance between the query, each fingerprint in the data set, and we return as a result of the query each the fingerprint that has the unbidden distance that is below a given threshold. How about the results? We have just tested this on a very small scale scenario, because in this small scale scenario, we are able most importantly, to do a comparison between a random projection and the uncompressed setting. So in this scenario, with only about 11,000 pixels, with the original size about 10 million pixels, we use this size of the reduction, so we use 500,000 bits for the random fingerprint. We can see that if we would like to implement our system with uncompressed peer review fingerprints, the dataset with a few pictures will take about 400 gigabytes. With our fingerprints, it takes less than 700 megabytes. So this is a huge reduction in storage for this dataset. Moreover, the complexity of the query is also greatly reduced. With uncompressed fingerprint, more than 2 minutes for a single query. With a compressed fingerprint, just about a second for a single query to our compressed datasets. You may ask, what are the performance, the matching performance of our system? Here you can see the curve, the comparison between recall and precision for our system. The red curve here is just the ideal performance that you can obtain with uncompressed or just binarization. And you can see that the degradation of performance by compressing the fingerprint with our strategy is very, very few. A very slight degradation of performance with respect to the ideal performance of the system. You can just give a look at the specific performance for the different camera in the experiment. In this experiment, we have just 50 different cameras to match with. You can see that there are some cameras where our system is performs poorly with respect, for example, to the recall performance. However, for the same camera, we can see that even the uncompressed fingerprint performs poorly. So this is just a problem of the peer new fingerprint for that particular brand sense of the camera. It's not a problem of compression. Compression usually performs very close to the performance of the uncompressed system. And this is true also according to the precision. The precision is slightly degraded, 2-3% degradation. But this can be acceptable if you bear in mind that the reduction in complexity is a factor over 1,000. So this is really huge. This makes possible to implement an image retrievable system in this setting. Just to conclude this presentation, well, we have presented this basic setting for performing an image search when we want to like to search in a huge data set, each picture that has been taken by the specific device, a specific sensor. And we have demonstrated that using our compressed peer review fingerprint, we can implement a search engine with a very high performance. The performance is very close to the uncompressed setting, the uncompressed peer review. And we have a much reduced complexity reduction, both for storage and for matching complexity. What comes next? Of course, this is just a preliminary result with a very simple linear search. We are just investigating more advanced searching algorithm using some hierarchical strategies that are made possible by the fact that random projection have an embedded representation. You can use a small part of random projection to have a fast match with a smaller complexity, take a subset of the candidates and perform a full search on this subset. Moreover, we are just implementing some strategy to comply with, for example, geometrical transformation. What happens if in our dataset we have a resized picture? And I invite you, we have also a demo showing this search engine, so if I invite you to join us tomorrow at 10 to Innovale, you can see a demo, you can test yourself the performance of our system. So, thank you for your attention, and if you have any question, I'm glad to answer it.
Thank you, Marco.
Thank you.
I have a question. How does this compressed PRNU depend on the method of estimating them in the first place? Because you are estimating them from the original image and from the filtered image, I see.
Okay.
It's when you determine this reference image in a different way, could they arise some errors or...
The method that you use for estimating the fingerprint affect the performance of a fingerprint matching. But this is the same for uncompressed and compressed PRNU. So if you use, for example, a different kind of filter, and this kind of filter enhances the matching performance on uncompressed PRNU, this is expected to have enhanced performance also on the compressed PRNU. We have demonstrated that we have just, according to the number of random projections, we have just a bound between the performance of the compressed system and the performance of the compressed one. We are just we can just have a relationship between the performance. If you have the performance, we do not have an epsilon gap between the performance of the compressor and the performance of the compressed system.
Thank you for the presentation, and I'm interested in the robustness of your method for the image modification, especially for the image compression, such as a JPEG or cannot be back to the original images. The most of the images in the web or the environment is compressed by the JPEG. So how do you think about such kind of compression or modification?
About compression, this should be not a big issue because there are results about the robustness of original and compressed PNU on JPEG compression, and it is really robust about JPEG compression. And also our results are based on this Dresden dataset, and this Dresden dataset contains JPEG images. They are not uncompressed images. But the problem is about the making PNU robust with different sides of the images. Because if you rescale the image, there is a PNU is robust if you can guess how much is the rescaling factor. But then this makes the comparison more more complex. It's more complex. So we have just devised efficient methods to make search in a kind of scale invariant way.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, now let's sing the speaker again.